Wings Rant, where tirades and impassioned pleas for your Detroit Red Wings finally have a home. Mike, the comments are blowing up. Everybody wants to talk about trading Leon.
There's nothing I love than a little tea spilling trade rumor talk. Yeah.
I can't believe we weren't met with, GTFO. That ain't happening. Talk about something else. Talk about Gemel. Talk about the new schedule. No, everybody wants to talk about Leon Draisaitl.
Let's talk Gemel on the fourth line. Woo!
Well, it is still exciting, but before we get into all that, Matt's, we always have our little bits of business to take care of, and it's been a while since I've shared this, so let me pull this up here for all the YouTube viewers. It's right at the shop. Mike, all the prices are finally fixed. You can head on over
to
brothersofdiscussion.com. Click on the shop button on the homepage of bodpodcast.com, brothersofdiscussion.com. Mike, I'm wearing these pants right now. This is there's a webcam. This is actually me right now. Yeah.
That was, I liked, when you let me take those photos of you for the website, you looked really good.
Yeah, I looked really hot. Yeah. Our new logo. The Red Wings Rant logo. I'm a huge fan of. Mike, I gotta say, this new zip hoodie with the the little Red Wings Rant on the chest pocket there, or where there would be a pocket. I don't know how to describe that. That's pretty hot. Yeah. Now this is my all-time favorite shirt, Mike. I accidentally put the white logo down and forgot to remove the white T-shirt. So you can get this in any color, but
look at this guy going 2012 Miami Heat, the white on white.
And nice. We got the white on red.
You got a little font that gets us this close to a lawsuit. I love it.
I've been waiting for it. So I will say, Teespring sent me the warning, and then they were like, no, the warning is you actually described your T-shirt as a Detroit Red Wings T-shirt. You can't do that. And I said, what about the logo? And they're like, yeah, logo's fine. It doesn't matter. It's the font. I paid for the font. I get to use the font. Bingo, bingo. Just like
I like it.
All right. Go to bodpodcast.com, brothersofdiscussion.com. You can find all of our Red Wings Rant stuff. Matt's drinking out of his Red Wings Rant mug. He's got a little bit of hot cocoa mixed with bourbon. He's wearing his Red Wings Rant T-shirt. Oh, wrong way.
Hey, I'm drinking out of a friend of the show, Matt, Cherry Dr. Pepper. And my shirt has a big yellow duck on it.
Okay. Everybody's really proud of you.
Yeah, and I have a matching hat, yellow. are we going to open up with the trade talk here?
Let's get the easy stuff out of the way. First things first. Shout out Silver and Tristan here. Two of Mike over the course of the last few months have both received a T-shirt on different occasions. A turd shirt. Sorry, guys. It was not made out of turds. It's an actual T-shirt. Going over, Mike, their Leon Draisaitl trade proposals. Thank you so much, guys. Shout out Fethdar's around.
Hey,
and Chewy Nichols. He's back. I think the Chewy's new, right?
He's mixing it up. He's got a new nickname this week.
Yeah, let's
you always call him Matt or Chewy. I'm calling him Chewy.
Let's call him Chewy. Mix that up every week. Tristan says the white on white is overpriced. Tristan, also ladies cut. So that's for the ladies in your life for Valentine's Day. That's what that's for.
You know what? I'm comfortable with myself. I'll wear a ladies white on white. I don't care.
Tristan, me and you, bud.
Yeah.
Some might see me from a distance and see the hips and wonder, should he be wearing lady cuts?
He looked great in white on white.
I've got some pretty shapely hips. Mike knows. Nobody else knows. Matt's always got the camera from.
It's true. There's a lot of gesturing and posturing, but right beneath that camera view line, you guys wish you could see it. It looks like an ostrich having a stretch.
Well, I said let's get the easy stuff out of the way. Mike, we got our schedule updates.
Thank God. So we want more 2022 regular season Red Wing games. Yes.
This is where the conversation starts because we have two fans that are talking at fans. Tristan. Oh, yeah, Mikey boy. The important reminders here, folks, remember to check your SeatGeeks, check your StubHub accounts for these games, because these are going to be cheap AF, I guarantee it. Valentine's Day was added, Mike. There's the key date.
Go ahead. We're being tongue-in-cheek about this, but this is actually kind of important because this is potentially, what, 1, 2, 3? Maybe a potential for a few more of them to actually have a little Verona action, Matt. Because, let's, you know, we're moving a couple into March, April.
Well, Max has made the comment that he thinks Verona's going to be back in February. So,
oh, Boltman?
Yeah, Max Boltman. Sorry. Max, you know, first name basis.
Friend of the show.
Oh, Matt. Matt does say everyone calls me Chewy. He said he tried to explain it the last live, and I think we didn't understand.
Oh, I like how we put the whole deviation from how it got to where it at. Yeah, where it's at.
Yeah, that's beautiful. My friends were never that creative. I remember in elementary
school. Bro, your last name's Clink. We're gonna call you Clink.
Yeah, that's how. It's still happening at work.
You guys, they already called my brother that. No, now you're both Clink. Okay.
Great, guys.
Goodbye, identity. But yeah, anyway.
Now, I wanted to point out, Mike, I thought this was pretty screwed up. We have our, if you're watching on YouTube, you have your original date and rescheduled date. If you guys check out, you know, it's, if you're listening to the podcast, you probably have already seen these updated dates. But yeah, go to at Detroit Red Wings on Twitter. It's all over. NHL.com, what have you. So I'm only going to pick out one here. I already mentioned that Valentine's Day is up. So if you guys, that's in Minnesota. So yeah, you can't go see it if you're in Detroit. But anywhoozles, what I wanted to point out, Mike, what I didn't like is that the Toronto game, Detroit at Toronto, was supposed to be February 26th, right? They moved it to April 26th, and the Toronto at Detroit was supposed to be April 26th and was moved to February 26th. Now, for all the Red Wings fans here, I know you guys will be on board. There certainly is a bias. I've noticed in my time as a hockey fan, a bias in favor of Toronto. Mike, did they not do this? Make the old switcheroo so that Toronto can have a home game at the end of the season to try and lock up whatever playoff spot they're trying to lock up. Tell me, am I the only one that noticed that? Because I thought it was pretty screwed up. I absolutely 1000% believe that's what we're looking at here.
See, I think you're looking at this as a glass half empty. You know, by that time, maybe Rona will be over. Maybe Canada will relax a little bit on the restrictions, and Bertuzzi can play in April. That's what those schedule makers are hoping for, a little twos action.
I mean, hopefully, but that's what I saw. I tell you, I was pretty angry. Not really angry, like, oh, the Red Wings should have had that, you know, home game in April. Like, we don't need it. But just because I could feel the bias in that move, and they'd make some excuse about, you know, travel or something like that needed to happen. Yeah. But I guarantee my conspiracy theory is correct. That's why they did it.
All right. I think we're good on this. On.
Nobody cares. Yeah.
No.
Especially Mike.
They want to talk Draisaitl. What's next, Matt?
Gamble's coming over.
Not quite Draisaitl, but the Red Wings did make a move.
Gemel Smith, Givani Smith's brother, 27 years old. Oh, I should have made that smaller. 5'11", 194 pounds. We're looking at the last few years here. If you guys are listening to the podcast, you've got some games playing for the Stars, played for Tampa a couple of times. He got to raise the cup. Pretty good for Gemel there. I saw that picture online today that he was skating around with the cup with his total of 8 games over 2 years with Tampa. One of those times got to end it where holding up the cup. So good for him. You know, that's how you got to do it sometimes.
So I know a lot of teams, like when they make transactions, I don't feel like they necessarily go through the entire Rolodex of the rest of the league. being in Detroit, I feel like we've seen that with, you know, like the Tigers seem to make trades with the same teams. The Pistons make acquisitions with, you know, same teams. Lions definitely do that when there's a new regime. You know, they hire a Rams guy, suddenly they bring in all these former Rams. Or they were a Patriots team, they bring in all these former Patriots. So this, you know, not a huge shock. You know, a guy, Tampa Bay Lightning, you know, coming over.
I'll argue against that because he was drafted by Dallas. He didn't come over to Tampa.
But we weren't interested until he was a Lightning.
Maybe that's true.
So I guess my question is, why?
I'm going to say first and foremost that there's a familiarity with Givani Smith. So that's probably where the conversation started, to be completely honest. Number two, Mike, I think there might be a possibility we see maybe some payback this Friday against Dallas. Maybe Jamie Benn's going to have to answer for some shenanigans from last season.
So you're saying there's some receipts that Gemel is going to be helping us out with?
Issued, yes.
Okay. I'm not against the move. You know, he's definitely scored a lot more in the minors than he has, you know, playing in the show. But, Matt, are you familiar with his work? What kind of – is he kind of similar to Givani, who I affectionately call the five-minute major man?
Well, what do we got here? We have our penalty minutes there that you can – you know, you're not really going to gather too much from those NHL games because they are, you know, small in sample. But – I think if you're looking at, like, what we see here, a minute per game at least, or actually, no, that second stint with Tampa Bay, that's 11 minutes in five games. So, you know, there's a good minor penalty per game there. Playing with the crunch, again, 50 minutes in 50 games. Maybe his best season, Providence Bruins in the AHL, 32 penalty minutes in 47 games. So, yeah, I mean, he's getting his fair share there. Maybe more than his fair share is what I mean to say, but compared to his brother, his fair share of penalties. Yeah, this is certainly low risk. This I think most of the conversation just turns into fun. Like, what do we have to do to get Givani and Gemel on the same line? And what are they going to do in regards to messing people up? Right? Was it the Bang Bros or the Bash Bros in the Mighty Ducks? Because that's what I'm...
I think Bang Bros is a gentleman's website, which I would definitely have your adult search settings on if you're going to look that up.
I wasn't thinking that, so I'm proud of myself.
See, the Bash Brothers is from the Mighty Ducks. So guys, be warned. Don't look up Bang Bros or look up Bang Bros.
Let me Google search Bash Brothers. Okay.
Make sure you do that on somebody else's phone.
Let me pull up my work laptop real quick. Tristan's got it, Bash Bros. Yeah, we've got the gifts and everything coming up.
Okay.
So yeah, be careful with the Bang Bro searches there, guys. Not on your work laptop.
Yeah.
Silver pointing out, Nil is Dallas's GM though. It's so confusing though because we're talking about we're talking a team ago. You know, not including the AHL stints. So I don't know. I'm not ready to play that game. I think first and foremost, we're talking a brother relationship here. That's why Gemel was picked up. They would probably deny that.
Do you think that we are picking him up to kind of help flesh out the... God, I don't even know if it's possible. Like, flesh out our Griffins or give him a cameo on the fourth line?
I don't know. This is not a move to, like, now this team is complete. Now this team has improved. This isn't that kind of move to me. I don't know. That's where I landed with the brother thing. I can't really pull too much out of this because it is possible that, you know, we're going to flip some guys, but then, you know, he's going to have to get sent down. And is he just going to get picked back up again? So is he got one game to play with Givani and then he's heading back to Tampa or something like that? I'm not really too familiar with the waiver wire. If we're going to send somebody down, when does Tampa get a shot at him again? I know how it works in fantasy. Any hoozles, there's not that much I want to dissect from it because I'm not, you know,
that's understandable. I know we're almost at the Draisaitl conversation. So it's hard to give these as much credence.
I mean, who's looking at this and going, cool. Now we locked up that fourth line. That's the fun. It's a fun thing to say, but it's not like a it's not a strategy. It's not a. I could be completely wrong. They could come together. We'll find out that that's all Givani needed. We're going to have a fourth line that not only can bang you. Oh, wait, bash you. Sorry, I got bang bro stuck on the mind. That can bash you. We'll also put pucks in net. We'll find out. Maybe he doesn't even dress. It's just one of those things. We'll see.
I'm pumped for his cameo. I'm just, it's not a Draisaitl acquisition. Yeah.
Mike, we also beat the Sabres.
Again.
Another topic you don't
want to talk about. We got their number. Just like the rest of the NHL. I know.
Yeah, Fethdar's with me. It's no coincidence that his brother's in the organization. See? There we go. That's the long and short of it. I got to believe that. I can't believe that Steve was like, get him! we beat the Sabres in OT. The fun thing here, Mike, this was a second straight game. Clearly, it's the Sabres, so a lot of teams do this, right? They dominate from a chance and possession perspective, which if you guys are watching on YouTube, you can see the numbers. I do have to blow it up here for all the podcast listeners, but, we are talking 61%, almost 62% in expected goals for percentage. In regards to possession, almost 62% Corsi 4 percentage, 60%. Fenwick, so there's your numbers of just getting attempts at the net. So from a 5-on-5 perspective, domination, game was close. The Red Wings, we're playing on the road. We just don't like it. Do we want to see any highlights, or you guys just want to move on and talk about
the guys? I don't know if we need to see the highlights. I think it's just another
I can pull it up. We never do this. Never let you talk while I pull up a highlight. But
no, it's just it's another notch in the most 500 team of all time, where we continue to, do pretty well against, teams that are like clearly not as talented as us. So I think that's one real positive to take out of this, is that the Red Wings do kind of seem to, take a little joy in playing the crap of the league, and just beating the who's he what's it's out of them. Larkin, another example here of, what Larkin looks like when he's healthy. Again, compliments to Darren McCarty.
Yeah, thanks, Darren, for that one. Yeah, Timmy, what's up, Timmy, throughout
our all-star, too.
OT highlight.
Yeah, our all-star, too.
What's going on, Timmy? I see we got an earlier message here of what's going on.
Timmy.
Yeah, this is one of those two, those overtime goals. It's more fun to say, we're going to get this video pulled. Play it three times. It's one of those things, if we're seeing a Suter goal or we're seeing a Lucas Raymond goal, mm-hmm. We get to dissect, oh my God, we get to see this guy in his moves, making choices on when they're going to accelerate and when are they making the move to get around the defender. We see how smart they are as rookies. This is just classic Dylan Larkin. This is something at least we get to look at this and go, Dylan's having the best season of his career. Easy peasy, 1-2-3-zy, right? Who's coming up with an argument about that?
I don't think there's much of an argument to be made.
Right. So that's the fun part of this. I watched it and I just remember, there was nobody watching it with me, but I just remember looking up in the air going, God damn. I was just so happy for Dylan. This is one of those things, you could celebrate a guy having his career year, because we know all the struggles he's had to go through, both personally, we know from his own game he's had some struggles, we've had injuries, and this team has done nothing to bring joy to his life, and now he's got a team that's above 500. So it's all feeling pretty good. But, Mike, there is still one more thing to dissect, I promise. We'll get to
Draissaitl
in a minute.
Okay.
Mike, over these last couple of games, so if you wind the clock back to January 15th, so that was, that's where this table came from. I can't remember what day we actually played the Sabres. But any hoozles, let's go back to the last two games. You can actually organize all the forwards, and the Red Wings have that second line up in the top 20. All three boys. Now, I highlighted Dylan Larkin and Tyler Bertuzzi here because they actually walk away with our two highest goals for per 60 scores. But I organized this table for everybody watching on YouTube by expected goals for percentage. And we talked a lot in the last episode about most of that December and half of January at that point. Everybody was under 50% for expected goals for percentage. And that's important for anybody not familiar with the expected goals for percentage, because you're basically measuring what are the chances you're putting on net and what is your opponent putting on net. So if you're under 50%, your opponent's doing better. And if your entire team, not just like a team score, every individual player was under 50%, not good. So Jeff made a couple of moves, granted, against the Sabres. Mike, we got Mark Stahl at the top of this list at almost 85% expected goals for over those two games. But again, at the top
85, of the list, you know what? 85, let's call it 100.
Yeah, 100% for Mark Stahl. But Pius, Tyler, and Robby Fabbri, when measuring forwards, they're right at the top of the league. And it's just, it's perfect, right? This Guelph Storm line really has a ton of chemistry. And the only thing going against it so far, I will say, like we saw Dylan Larkin come in with a goal, kind of playing the Pius Suter role as he stormed in, if I may say stormed in. And Robby Fabbri found Larkin out front. And that's how that line scored in the second game out of two against Buffalo. But, you know, Pius has gotten quite a few chances and he's missed all of them. You can actually see his actual goals for per 60 over this period is zero compared to the 4.28 that Tyler Bertuzzi's carrying right now, if you guys are looking at the table. So that's his actual goals for is zero. So that means while Pius has been on the ice, no goals have gone in, despite that second line being one of the strongest in the NHL this last week. That's no reason to kick Pius off the line. I think there's still a ton of chemistry building. And clearly, I think the important thing here looks to be Tyler and Fabbri playing together. But Pius has had some rough breaks. I think a couple of times they gave him passes right out in front of the net, and he just slammed the puck right into the goaltender. So not much you can do about that. But he'll come around. Like, this isn't just like getting more chances than your opponent. I mean, these all look like great chances that this line was putting together. I just think it has to be shouted out.
I think it's important for you to bring it up because it's a theme that we've repeated quite a few of our episodes where it's not like these guys, you know, when we're not, you know, in the top tier of the NHL, it's not like they're devoid of talent. It's just that some of them are being asked to do things that they probably shouldn't have to do when you're an upper echelon playoff team. So, like, you know, Pius, Fabbri, and not really Bertuzzi. He's just, you know, kind of hanging out there to, you know, play the Blashill Boggle, as we've affectionately come to call it. Like, Pius, Fabbri, and, you know, kind of looking at you, Zadina. Once those guys are to the point where they're third liners, I think that's where this team gets really good, right?
Yeah.
That's where, you know, Verana is back, so everybody can kind of like reshuffle down the pecking order a little bit.
I know what you're doing.
And then, you know, maybe you get that upper echelon center, Matt. Now, I'm not saying it has to be Draisaitl, but we are going to bring it up because this is crazy. It's, you know, potentially something to even talk about. And because he's so good, you have to bring it up. But, Matt, even if it's not him, we have another big offseason coming up. I know Tristan has talked about it. You can't wait for this season to be over. Me neither. I can't wait for this offseason. I can't wait for this trade season first and then this offseason. But, you know. But, yeah, I mean, you can see where basically two pieces, which obviously are very tough pieces to get, you know, a top six center and, you know, a healthy Verana, at least for right now, it's going to make a world of difference, Matt. So these games, seeing these guys perform, it pours a little of that Red Wing Kool-Aid into the veins that, you know, this is not hopeless. This is something that, you know, we're definitely progressing forward. So it's something to be positive about.
Well, I got to throw out there, we got some good comments. Muffin Man Brand, I love the logo. I love the name. Throws out
there. I don't know what I love more. I love both of those.
Yeah, look at the little smile on that cute little muffin. He's so happy. Yeah. First line levels, of course, talking about Pius, Bertuzzi, and Fabbri. Our boy Performance Art made it. It's a little late to the party. Ciao. I do like this comment Tristan threw out there. If Holland was running this team, he'd see those Mark Stahl stats, sign him for 5 years at $5 million, and tout him as an EK65 in his prime. where are we going? Joey, if he played all 82 games, he'd be on pace for 42 goals. Is this a follow-up comment to your Larkin has officially reached elite levels? That seems like those two add up.
Yeah, he's definitely on that pace. You know, definitely on pace to hit, you know, new career highs for him and be that elusive point of game guy. Looks like he's going to do it. It looks like he's going to do it.
Tristan, throw it out there. This is maybe we'll figure this into the next conversation, but he doesn't see Fabbri signing making sense for the future of this team. It's a high price tag for what he brings as being a one-dimensional offensive player. I will say I looked up his evolving hockey mm-hmm. wrap 'em chart today. There's a lot of red. It goes deep into the red. Robby Fabbri does not test out as a positive player in any way, shape, or form. There's way too much he's giving up, and it's not even like the offense that comes into play is doing spectacularly. So that's from an analytics perspective, but clearly from a Blashill perspective, he's doing great. Chewy, next year's going to be awesome. How are we going to make it awesome, Mike? Well, Muffin Man Brand brings up, watching Holland destroy the Oilers makes me happy, just because it's not happening to us anymore. Well, Mike, Holland might be bringing something over to us, as you've been hinting at all episode. And I'm sorry for making you wait. I'm sorry for making fans wait.
No, you're fine. Yeah, Matt, can you because I think you – yeah, thank you. That's exactly what I was going to ask about. And it's the whole genesis of this conversation that this – very uncomfortable interview if you are a part of the Oilers management team. Like, oh God, what's about to happen to us?
Right. And what we're setting up here is the Leon Draisaitl press conference. And Jim Matheson, who has been labeled across many channels as a Hall of Fame reporter. I don't know we can talk about this when this is done and then we can get it in the Draisaitl conversation, but this is league news, Mike. This is sports news. So we can just touch on this and give our opinions right before we start trading for Draisaitl. We'll talk about why, you know, like you said, the genesis of this, why we think this could mean Draisaitl on the trade block, but, yeah, I got it pulled up here, right? We should listen to it. Let me know, Mike, right away, as always, if you cannot hear it, because that means nobody else can.
Lots of reasons for why the Oilers are...
Screwed it up.
It was working.
Oh, could you hear that?
Yeah.
Playing the way they are in terms of winning and losing. What do you think's the number one reason for the losses now? Is there one thing that you, in your own mind, you're saying, we got to get better at that?
Yeah, we have to get better at everything.
Would you like to expand on that?
Nope. You can do that. You know everything.
Why are you so pissy, Leon? Why are you so pissy?
I'm not. I'm just answering your
question. Yeah, you are. Whenever I ask you a question.
I gave you an answer.
Not very good one.
Okay.
I have one more for you. Leon, you show your frustration on the ice last game against Ottawa. Is that a good thing when you show it so the other team knows you're frustrated?
Yeah, it's a great thing, for sure.
Good.
Yeah.
Lots of reasons for why.
All right. Yeah. What an awkward moment there. Yeah, Joey Furtado saying, free Draisaitl. What an unprofessional question, though. Why are you being pissy? Come on.
Yeah, man. Isn't that... Like, what I tweeted out, and I was actually pretty happy because I never see that stuff when it first comes out, and I'm always, like, giving my opinion hours later. So I saw that live, and I said, clearly unprofessional, but, I mean, isn't Jim being a little pissy there himself?
Like, yeah, that journalist was... Yeah, it's really
Jim Matheson. Yeah, around. He's like 70, I think, or 74 or something like that. Tristan threw it out there that George Larocque also came out, made some pretty sickening info, and put out some sickening info on that on Jim Matheson. Silver thrown out there. He made it personal, completely unprofessional. Tristan wants me to pull up the McKinnon interview from last year's playoffs. I had the Draissaitl ready to go, and you guys saw how long that took me to get ready. So if I got to start researching.
No, don't worry about that. We'll stick with this one.
But if I may, this is something from a journalist perspective. I saw somebody arguing a journalist has to do what they've got to do to get an answer. And my reply to that guy on Twitter was, you honestly think that the best thing that journalists could have done was insult Draisaitl to try and get an answer out of him when he was already being short with him? Like, Dreisaitl's being short with Jim, so clearly you should insult him to try and get an answer. It's like, no, if anything, this guy's job, and I get it, a lot of people said, you know, part of their job isn't just playing hockey, it's to talk to the media. Fine. But also, he's a human being. And, like, if I'm managing a team, and I mean, like, a team at my job, not managing a hockey team. If I'm managing a team and I can see that somebody's pissed off, is your first inclination for anybody? Do you poke the bear? Or do you, like, lay off?
So I think this...
So it wouldn't be Jim's job to make Leon Draisaitl feel better, but it is not any journalist's job to poke the bear and make it worse.
No, it's not. But I think what's probably going on is it sounded like Matheson is kind of run into this before, quite a few times with Draisaitl. So this was just kind of, we see, much like in a hockey game, you end up seeing the penalty. You don't see like the back and forth that was happening on the first and second shifts in the first period when guys were chirping with each other and being a little too rough. So you just, you end up seeing the penalty at the, second period or something like that. So we're kind of jumping in at the end of this story where Draisaitl's, getting pretty frustrated, and this journalist is also pretty frustrated. But I think for our purposes, the reason that we bring this up is, it sounds like Draisaitl is kind of fed up with this Edmonton scenario. And that's where we kind of have this dream where, my God, what if he's actually on the board? What if he demands a trade? Mm-hmm. We're kind of in this magical era of, player empowerment where these guys finally feel brave enough to, say, I don't want to play here anymore. You can't make me.
Right.
Go ahead and find me. I'd rather be fined than, play for your shitty team, your shitty organization. And I'm going to just say, before you get into it, Matt, is I'm very happy to be part of this era. It's insane to me that we just used to blindly say whatever the organization wants, that's probably best, instead of the player themselves. The one who's actually doing the playing. That's where our loyalty should lie. Not with the team. But Matt, I don't want to get too into the weeds with that debate.
Well, I got to throw out there, Chewy said, that's hilarious. Dumb question gets a dumb sarcastic response.
Yeah.
Absolutely, it should. Yep. Performance Art is poking me the bear because he says he doesn't see a big deal with that interview. Happens all the time. All right, thanks, Performance Art.
Yeah. Calling players pissy is just, what are you doing, man?
Performance art. Actually, he continued later. As a reporter, you do poke the bear. That's where they hope to.
I think you poke the bear by asking good questions, not ask why are you being pissy.
Yes.
The provocative question is how you're supposed to intellectually poke the bear, not just try to piss off a guy into giving you a colorful interview so you can sell some clicks, later that night.
Mike, I brought it. I brought the example on Twitter, and I'm going to use a bad word. But if you're having a bad day at work, and somebody you don't know just walks up to you and can see that you're having a bad day, and they're just like, tap you on the shoulder. Hey, why are you being a little bitch? Are you going to be thrilled with that? And this is what I want. This is how I want everybody to be in this thinking space. Like, the idea of, let's not just blindly support the media. I'm not, Performance Art, that sounds really accusatory. I'm not saying you're doing that. But I just, why were we taking the side of the media? Like, they have done us wrong so many times. So it seems like at this point we could choose to take Draisaitl's side, because if you put yourself in those shoes... Like, I'm also not going to be Jim Matheson. I don't think I'd ever see anybody that was upset and push him on the shoulder and go, why are you being a little bitch? Like, I would never do that. So I see myself being more Draisaitl. Yes, short. Yes, maybe I am pissy. But I'm also struggling in my main job, which is trying to win hockey games. Not score goals, win hockey games. So yeah, I'm going to be upset with myself. And when somebody calls me out on it, who really is just there as like a critic, you know, they're not really, it's not like your coach called you out. Just some, you know, 70-year-old guy who's been writing about hockey for years. Screw him. Screw that guy. All right, but Mike, let's get rid of some Red Wings so we can bring Draisaitl over here. What do you say? We got.
Yeah, I mean, so I think that again, we're really reading into this interview.
Right, we're having.
You know, the Oilers are just, you know, they're in a really rough spot. They've lost like 12 of like 14 games, something like that, and then like what, like 6 or 7 in a row now. They're basically out of, you know, playoff contention. If it started today. Their goalies have been absolutely horrible. And it's basically, you know, Connor and Draisaitl and the Pips. That's what's going on here. It's far-fetched, of course. But if, by God, you know, Draisaitl is just so effing fed up, he's tired of, you know, being in public talking about this team. He's tired of playing for this team. He's tired of playing, you know, for Ken Holland. God damn it, I want to trade. Yzerman up the phone and he's going to make an offer, and we thought that would be something fun to talk about on this episode. So what are we putting on the table?
Well, let's start with some of the early comments before the show even started. Tristan threw out there our 2022 first, 23 first, Philip Sedina and Robby Fabbri for Leon Draisaitl. Mike, I would do this as a Red Wings fan to pick up Draisaitl in a heart. Like I would a million times out of a million do this. I wouldn't even give it a second thought. Draisaitl is what you want out of those first round picks. Boom. We're happy with Lucas Raymond, Mike. Very good chance he never even sniffs Draisaitl. Well, sniffs, that's objective, but, you know, I mean, you know, like a consistent over a point per game season kind of thing. Like once he hits his prime, top two scoring in the league, like that still could be in the cards for Lucas in the future, but we don't know. But we do know Draisaitl can do it. So what do you want out of a first round pick is Draisaitl. So getting rid of two first round picks, no skin off my back, Sedina, peace, Robby Fabbri, toodles, boom.
That offer is very appealing to the Red Wings.
Yes. I don't know. I think you might have to add, Mike, let's do this. Should we do this? Can we make this? Can we move guys around and try and make this work?
I think what I would do is I can try to make it more appealing for Edmonton because they would be giving up, you know, a guy who's probably going to be a Hall of Famer. I mean, he's that skilled. He's that accomplished already. And I think Tristan's off to a good start with the firsts. But let's put it in perspective. Like we talked about this, how bad we wanted Pettersson in the offseason. And if you're going to put in a real contract offer for him, it would have involved two firsts, a second and a third, which is like the restricted free agency tier. When you're like, you know, about 8 to 10 million, Draisaitl, like his wins above replacement are just unbelievably high. I mean, he's worth, God bless America, I don't know, 12, 13, 14 million, just, you know, based on production. So that to me, whew, you're maybe talking like four first round picks, Matt. I would say, my God, if Yzerman can find a way to nickel and dime that down to three first round picks and players, that would probably be the starting point. Do you think that, you know, three first rounders would be enough, or is that too much for Yzerman? Because you're still right. Going to need players.
That's part of the conversation. Somebody's about to change Leon Draisaitl right now, so I'm going to pull this off. Yeah, there you go. Smash now. That's the problem with Jay Fresh cards. You got 1,000 people playing in the same Excel spreadsheet, and your shit keeps changing while you're trying to look up stuff. But yeah, that's a great question. Do you want to give up 3 years of first round picks? Is Draisaitl going to pull you so far into relevance that you're not looking at those first round picks to continue to build a team at this point?
I mean,
go ahead.
So I think what you want to do is you want to be able to make this trade, but not leave yourself so barren that you're the Edmonton Oilers, where right. You have a couple excellent players tough. And then the Pips.
Can I point out a trade I think would look more appealing that was brought up before the show started?
Ooh, yeah.
And we're gonna lose a pretty highly regarded player right now. I think he's becoming a fan favorite, and it was Silver throughout there. 2022-2023 first, Nedeljkovic, Berggren, and a prospect. Now, everybody forgive me here. Silver, if you're seeing this and you're like, no, it's Berggren or a prospect, and you're putting it in the chat, there's 100 messages between this and what you're saying now. So I'll scroll down in a minute. But, Mike, I think this gets us closer. We're getting rid of those first-round picks. Nedeljkovic is doing pretty great right now, and I feel like Edmonton would be on board with trying to finally pick up their goaltender and solve that problem that's been an issue forever. They get a Berggren who, I mean, he's coming out. We didn't even get to mention this. Last night, 4 assists for the Griffins. Was supposed to be a show topic, completely forgot. But hey, we mentioned it, so now I can keep it on YouTube. Got four assists last night. We just showed his highlights of that overtime goal the other day. So clearly Berggren has some skill. I mean, middle six, right? Middle six prospect. Sometimes Draisaitl's playing on the second line, so you can make the argument, all right, there's a second line replacement right there. Now, this is where it gets interesting, is adding another prospect to this. Mike, you got to figure a defenseman is another thing that Edmonton would love, especially considering, as I pull up cap friendly here, a guy like Darnell Nurse, who's going to be collecting $9.25 million next year. Man, they've still got Duncan Keith to pay next year. Tyson Barrie's got 4.5 for the next however many years, 3 years. So none of these guys are necessarily coming in cheap. So they could get a cheap defenseman, Mike, if you take a look at our prospect pool. But you got to believe if it's Leon Draisaitl, and you're only giving up Berggren so far, you're giving up a Nedeljkovic, it's probably got to be Edmondson, right?
I got to say, as far as the Red Wings 3 Calder candidates go this year, Nedeljkovic is probably the one I would least want to trade, because I feel like the Red Wings are not doing a super duper ultra fantastic job of, you know, having like ready to go goalie prospects. I know we're really pumped about Kosa because he's 6'6", but I feel like Ned is the one I would keep. And if I'm the Oilers, I feel like they would come into the room asking for Raymond or Suter, and then you also, like, to kind of flip-flop it, you throw in Berggren or Edmondson. So it's either going to be firsts Raymond Edmondson or firsts Berggren Suter. So they're getting a forward and a defenseman, and you're giving up pieces that you really want as a Red Wings fan. Like, we really like, you know, Lucas. We really like Mo. But are all those pieces going to be a win above replacement that gets up to Draisaitl? Obviously, if he gets hurt, you know, that's one man that, you know, it's hard to replace. But are all those guys going to be able to catch up to that?
I mean, this is that point of the conversation where I go, if I'm Steve, I'm hanging up. Because that's a lot. We're still pretty far away. One piece does not change this team. So, there are going to be teams that have more spots filled that probably have comparable prospects to Berggren and Edmondson right now that, we don't know what those guys are going to turn out to. So when I say that, you know, that leaves me a lot of wiggle room with that comment. But, I mean, even if, you know, you were to take a guy like, what's his name? Pronman, from, what, an episode or 2 episodes ago? I mean, he's talking about 40 guys that are comparably possibly better than Edmondson in his little list. So if you were to take that, that just gives you an idea. Maybe only half those guys are better. Maybe Edmondson's going to turn out to be the best guy, but there's still at least 40 guys that right now you can make the argument are as good or better than Edmondson. So I just put that out there. There's a team that can afford to bring on Draisaitl, has a similar prospect to an Edmondson or Berggren, and can give up some draft picks and pull him in. And they're the team that is a Draisaitl away from winning. So for us, you can't give up all those prospects and two draft picks. But I do like, so this goes out to Joey, who said, are Raymond and Sider both untouchable to in the Draisaitl trade? It's just,
to me, I think that's just that we own them. I think that calling them untouchable is like a Ken Holland move. They are expendable because there are not a lot of elite Hall of Fame centers.
Ken Holland does like giving up his young guys.
There are not a lot of Hall of Fame elite centers, and that's what Draisaitl is going to be. So if you're saying that you're going to give up a defenseman who's really good, or Raymond, who's, you know, had a pretty good rookie season, or Draisaitl, an established, like, 100-point scorer, there's only, like, five of those guys in the whole league. Those guys are definitely on the table.
I think you risk a lot by saying no, but I disagree with you. Again, I come back to the point that there are teams that could make that
trade. Some
people are
Ken Holland, and some people like winning Stanley Cups. So,
well, I'll tell you this. Draisaitl hasn't won a Stanley Cup, and he's got Connor McDavid on a whole nother line. And we don't have a Connor McDavid. So
but we do have Yzerman to fill in the peripherals instead of Ken Holland.
Yeah, but that's also, like, his plan is to keep these guys and grow by, you know, quantity and quality, not just one quality. So it does cause a lot of problems to do that, I think. I think it puts us in the position where...
Is it, for you, is the issue, like, the quantity of high-end assets that we're giving up? Like, what if the...
Yeah, going back to that argument where I said there's other teams that can give up that similar... you know, maybe you want to say Raymond and Suter are the two best prospects right now, but there's still guys, like, within the top 40... top prospects that are on the same team that somebody could send over to Edmonton plus the draft picks, and they're a lot closer to winning. So I feel like they're in that boat to just hand over draft picks and prospects. That's not us right now. Because we have a bunch of guys that we can look at this roster and say, if our team was to be built through the draft, a ton of these guys aren't going to be a part of the team. Where, you know, Edmonton, we just went over all those guys that have long-term contracts and they're huge contracts and they're guys that they're doubling down on. So you don't want to start looking at Namestnikov going, well, I got to keep him. He's had some success on the first line, so now he's just a forever guy. That's supposed to be one of the guys we're saying bye to soon so that we can start bringing in some of the young guys or, you know, bringing in another free agent that's comparable for another couple years, but... That's where my head's at with that. I will say performance art threw out a great idea because this goes to more along the lines of like Ken Holland's thinking, but you also give Ken Holland a guy that he's drafted. Going back to Tristan's trade, Mike, throw in Tyler Bertuzzi.
See, performance art, that's what I said, but we'd have to figure out the whole, Matt brought up to me that we'd have to figure out the whole vaccination thing.
Yep.
Because he wouldn't be able to play home games. He'd be like Kyrie Irving in the NBA who can't play home games for Brooklyn. So he just gets the night off.
Yeah, it's something where you kind of, like, we talked about it before the episode started, but we were both kind of like, ooh, let's get rid of Bert. That'd be great. He's valued at $10 million right now, according to Dom Luce Chisholm. And, you know, then you go, oh, right. He's got to get vaccinated for this to work. And I doubt that the Red Wings are going to come up to Tyler and his family and be like, hey, here's the thing.
We want See, it's weird to me that you Edmonton. That you jumped to trade Bertuzzi, but not Lucas and Mo.
Me?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I don't think that's that crazy. I mean, Bertuzzi is proving to be a reliable producer on those top two lines, but I think he produces in a different way than like you would see Lucas Raymond or Moritz Seider doing it. Like you're talking about.
Let's look at it. Let's look at it this way, man. I'm going to give you four assets. I just want you to rank them by most least expendable to most expendable. Nedeljkovic, Lucas, Mo, Bertuzzi. Least expendable to most expendable.
I'm gonna go Mo, Lucas, Ned, Bert.
Wow. I would have done Ned, Mo, Bert, Lucas.
I just goalies to me, I mean, look at you know the likes of Jordan Binnington. You know, Ned has done great. But even Jeff said it, you know, part of that is politicking, but Jeff said it in his press conference, I think either yesterday or a day ago, but he said, you know, like goaltender is such a up and down position. You can show that you've got it, but the production or the stats just don't seem to follow goaltenders year in and year out. Goalie's expendable to me.
If he ends up being Vasilevsky, I mean, that's something totally different, right? Cause
sure.
I mean, I think it's...
He's also a guy that struggled to stay in the AHL a couple seasons ago. So, I mean, you could be... You want to talk trends.
He might have figured it out.
He could have. I'm just saying. Like, we're not looking at any of these guys as sure things right now, right?
Yeah. It just seems to me like Mo has the highest ceiling, and he's already really good. I feel like I can find another really good wing, you know, who's... You know, kind of that size as Lucas. And then Bert, I just value him more because he's already like there proving it. You know, like we can count on him. If he has a big night, he can put a whole team on his shoulders. I'd be kind of interested. Have any of our folks weighed in yet? Like for the least expendable to most expendable?
All right, Tristan's got one. I think I'm reading this right. He's got number four as Cider, number three Ned, number two Lucas, number one Bertuzzi. Tristan, I'm gonna guess what I think you mean, and you just correct me in the comments. But I think his least expendable is Cider. Guy he's most willing to give up is Bertuzzi. So Cider, Ned, Lucas, Bertuzzi.
Yeah. Okay.
So what did I say? I said Cider, Lucas, Ned, Bertuzzi. So I'm like right there. And, you know, I think one thing you missed too, Mike, because you went, whoa. But we're ranking four guys. That doesn't mean, like, I'm shooting them up, like, 25% going, like, Bertuzzi is this much. Like, we're only looking at four guys. So the margin is razor thin. But that's just where, like, looking at it right now, we're looking at a Bertuzzi who will not get vaccinated for this team. I think the contract's going to be a huge pickle to have to figure out in the future. And he also plays a game that's, I think it's a high effort game that he's been very successful with producing, but I don't know how long that carries compared to a guy who has this high skill. And we're not even looking at Lucas Raymond as like, he's got high skill and he's super fast. So we got to worry about his legs going. Lucas isn't super fast. He just knows how to move. He's that kind of guy. So that's what I was trying to say before was we're looking at two guys that are going to be successful in this. I hope Lucas will be successful. We're looking at Bertuzzi, who is successful right now, but they're going to be successful for two different reasons. So that's where I would say there's more value in a Lucas than a Bert.
Yeah. I mean, Bert, you know, taking the Canada days off is definitely going to hurt his value. It's just, I would just say that only at this juncture, like, you know, a couple more consistent seasons from Lucas, you know, he's easily going to, eclipse value than Bertuzzi, but he's just not there yet, so I would still say Bert has a little more value.
And I did nail it with Tristan's list there. Chewy throws out there a good defense can make regular goalies better. I think we see that with the majority of the league. We have seen Mike, as you actually we pointed out in the last episode, but I think you're saying too, the last month and a half has been all in the Nedeljkovic, like him keeping it, even though we've been losing. He's been keeping us in some of these games.
Yeah, he's played so well that, you know, we know how much this town and nationally how much people love Cider and Lucas's production. But now Nedeljkovic has been so good. it looks like he could potentially run away as a 26-year-old with the Calder Trophy.
Now, Fethdar is on board with Tristan's list. Performance Arts there, too. Muffin Man Brand definitely isn't easy to come by. Fethdar throws out there, like, this is my two and three. Lucas versus Ned is debatable. And I think Performance Art, this is a critique on you, Mike. You keep Ned, but let Lucas fly. Is that a question? Or is it a statement? You keep Ned, let Lucas fly.
No, I thought he was, that was his
that
opinion.
Is a statement.
You
yeah.
keep Nedeljkovic, and then Lucas is the trade, the asset you'd be more comfortable trading, because I think it's easier for you to find a guy on the wing.
Can I make the argument that maybe it's super easy to find a goaltender since we found Nedeljkovic for...
I mean, it's easy for Yzerman to swindle somebody for a goaltender, which is something entirely different.
Like, it's taken us forever to find a Lucas Raymond and a Mo Sider, and then who've had, you know, half a season of success. But then Nedeljkovic, Yzerman's just like, here's a draft pick.
I mean, that's a
really
good point.
We've also seen Grice and Bernier throw in some pretty successful seasons around two... or
porous Swiss cheese defenses. Yeah,
exactly.
But so, it also means that Yzerman, with you know, falling down the lottery, he's still able to find a really good wing and a really good defenseman that nobody saw coming, but he has yet to find that center.
I mean, I called Lucas, you know, like,
oh, blow it out your keys.
I was like, they better get Lucas Raymond. I don't know about that left wing year guy.
Oh my God. it just, you know, Yzerman has not found a center yet, and that's because it's not an indictment on him. I think it's just that much harder to find, you know, somebody excellent at that spot.
Joey throwing out there, Raymond and Sider are the most valuable to this team. Muffin Man Brand, I think he was talking about me here. He just says he's got the stuff. So he's just talking about good old Matt. Just kidding. I don't.
There's no way that's true.
That happened 3 minutes ago, so that could have been any number of those four guys. Chewy does want to see an Nedeljkovic Kosa combo at some point. Performance Art. Oh, this is him saying what you said, Mike. You keep Ned, trade Lucas.
And again, can't harp on it enough. Love Lucas, but you know, if it's Draisaitl, yeah, I'd give up Lucas.
Well, Performance Art's got it. This will.
There we go.
Nail it for Ken. Chance? Here's his Performance Art. Any chance we could find a way to throw Grice in there?
Now, Performance Art, you're asking that question, but I think Yzerman would also ask that question. Any way I could throw Grice in there? No.
I think that's happening.
No, we don't want Thomas Grice.
Ken Holland's pulled the phone. I don't know why.
I'm getting another call, Steve. No, wait. I was just kidding. We'll keep him.
So they've wrapped up the trade at that point, and Steve throws in there, and Thomas Grice.
You already agreed.
Like, Ken was about to hang up, and he's like, what was that?
What?
No, nothing, Ken. It's fine.
I said you agree, right?
All right,
you
agree. See you later, Steve.
Yeah.
And Thomas Grice. What did you say? Gets his facts in a minute. There's this big smudge. So the original copy clearly states Thomas
Grice. What's
this
redacted portion, Steve?
We're having donuts. It's Pochki Day in Detroit.
Pochki Day? What the? Wait, why are these Pochkis $3.6 million? How many Pochkis did you order?
It
says G. Yeah,
Grice for Draisaitl already makes Kenny's ears perk up. I think they're perking up right now. He's all about it. He heard, how quickly can I get rid of Draisaitl? It's tough, Mike. I mean, like, I pulled up the elite prospects list here for all of our prospects, everybody in the system. And I was going to play this game of, like, would you give up, you know, so-and-so. But you've already said you're trading away. Mike, you're going to trade away 4 years of first-round picks, Lucas Raymond and Mo Sider, Bergeron.
I'm not saying.
I'm just kidding.
Necessarily.
But you're putting those two, you would put them in the trade, so there's no point in me even playing this game, because it's not like I'm going to throw out Joe Valeno and you're going to be like, whoa, hold up there, mister. If you're ready to give up Mo Sider or Lucas Raymond, you are ready to
Valeno
give up
and the Smith brothers
on this list.
We're giving you both the Bang Bros.
Woo! Now, the other question would just be like... How many first round picks are you really willing to give up? Because I think you're going into three, and you are talking, Mike, you're talking about moving Lucas, Mo, if not both, definitely one of them. And then you're giving up another one of the two juicy guys. Now there's maybe a world where you don't lose Edmondson or Berggren, and maybe you can throw in somebody else. Like maybe you punish Ken Holland and say, hey, you got to take Zadina because you drafted him, mister. You got to make it work.
There's
that possibility.
One other funny aspect is it's almost like Ken Holland wouldn't want the draft picks, right? Because he's like, you know how I am with evaluating talent. No, Steve, I want the guys that you picked. So you pick them, and then you trade them to me. Don't let me this up. Is that DeKeyser for Draisaitl one for one? That's too one-sided. They'd have to throw Draisaitl and probably McDavid. That's too much.
All right, so I was just kind of making this joke, and I feel bad because performance art threw this out there. But Valeno, Zadina, Raymond, and a 2022 first.
Ooh.
I think if you throw it a 2022 or a 2023 and Mo Sider, and you get rid of Valeno and Zadina, they say.
I think we can almost get. I think we can almost get Kyle Quincy for that, man.
I mean, we are talking about a guy that's traded for Kyle Quincy. So
twice.
Yeah. So, I mean, it is possible to bamboozle Ken Holland here.
We're giving him way too much credit.
We might be. People might be listening to this and thinking, no, Ken Holland wants to see Domestikov and Danny DeKeyser.
Listen, DeKeyser got an expiring deal. He's a locker room leader. Oh, man, you're going to love him.
Yeah, we're going to do half retained on both sides. Ashton Hathaway throws that out there for DeKeyser and Draisaitl. See, this is fun. This is a great topic. I'm glad I feel like I built up the anticipation by doing all those other dumb topics for this episode.
We appreciate it, man. Thank you.
Yeah. Silver appreciates that thought, Ashton, just in case you didn't catch that in the comments. Chewy thrown out there. That's how you spell.
Hey, I like that. Yeah,
boy.
A little Polish spelling. I like that.
I don't know why I read this. It was Craig McDonald, and I was like, I was ready to make a Connor McDavid's brother joke, and my brain is so melted right now. I had to work till 7 o'clock today, so I ran over here to start this episode. Craig says, what are you guys smoking? Now, are we smoking stuff in regards to getting rid of Danny DeKeyser? Because that's good fun. Or are we smoking stuff? Because Craig's like, how could you possibly give up Lucas Raymond and Sider?
I think what Craig meant was the DDK for Draisaitl straight up, which, yeah, obviously is still too one-sided. Would have to include Connor McDavid. But, Craig, I do want to hear your trade offer, by the way.
Very real possibility. As I see the viewership count up and down, that somebody tuned in. It's on the Danny DeKeyser mention.
Who are these cartoons?
All right, delete this.
Yeah.
Now, Tristan, I've been saving this one, so Tristan's thrown out there. You've got to make sure we throw this out there. We've got to get a shirt that has Mike on it saying "Sell the Farm." I love it.
Do it.
I can actually design that pretty easily. We got a little farm.
You Mike, know what? Farms are nice. You know what's even nicer, Matt? Grocery stores. It's already grown. You can eat it.
But yeah,
Edmondson is a little seed in the dirt. And you know what? I appreciate whoever takes care of that seed for, months and months on end, watering it and sunning it and fertilizing it. You know what I like? I like going to the grocery store and getting me a nice big old piece of produce and munching away on it. You know how much effort that took? None, because it's ready to go. So I will definitely sell the farm for the yielded crop any day of the week.
All right. Now this
there we
is...
go. Oh,
Joey's
no.
Joey's thrown out there. Two first.
Valeno,
Zadina, Niederbach, and Johansson. Both having pretty good seasons. The last two, Niederbach and Johansson, having pretty good seasons overseas.
Yeah.
Valeno and Zadina, we know where they're at. You could maybe look at Ken, like do a FaceTime instead of a phone call. Look him in the eye. Oh, I think Mike's got to go. So we'll wrap up after this. Looks like he's getting in trouble there. But you could look Ken in the eye on a FaceTime and throw out Valeno and Zadina there and kind of, you know, you did this to me.
Listen, I don't dislike this idea, right? It's pretty prospect heavy.
I would do it.
And this is something that Red Wing fans be like, whoo, we dodged one there, huh? Yeah. But if Edmonton takes this, I mean, that is irresponsible. There's, because those firsts are going to start getting towards the end of the first round because of how much of a contribution Draisaitl is going to make.
So Tristan says, don't do it. don't do this, Joey. But I'm all about it. Oh no, he's just kidding. All right, he's on board. Yeah,
he's kidding. Yeah. No,
I was going to say, I'm all about this. Yeah, toodaloo.
Yeah, I mean, this would be a win for the Red Wings. This would be a landslide victory. This would be up there with the Nedeljkovic swindling that Yzerman did.
Because if Matt was smart enough.
Oh, he might have that queued up for us. Clip of the show.
Yeah, you do that trade, right, Mike? And then you ask Steve. What was Ken Holland thinking?
Why do you think the Oilers gave up Leon Draisaitl for like two pretty good prospects and Zadina, who's never scored a goal in his life?
You'd have to ask them why they were comfortable doing that. I don't know.
Man, it was muted. It didn't even work.
Really?
You'd have to ask them why they were comfortable doing that. I don't know.
That really didn't work.
Yeah, I don't know why Matt muted it, Steve. I have no idea why Matt muted you for a second, but aww. I'm glad that he came back.
I don't know how to unmute it. It just...
Here, I'm going to do it one more time. Steve, why do you think the Oilers accepted two middling prospects?
Ha! They hear it!
Jared Shaw's back!
Yeah, Jared said he came in late and he's really confused about what's going on. So it's coming an hour into Red Wings Rant. It's...
Yeah.
You're about 8 segments deep.
It's a real crap show right now. Yeah.
Yeah, that means I've had an hour for the booze to run through the bloodstream.
Sweet booze.
Hot chocolate with bourbon. It worked out pretty good. Wow. All right. Mike, I saw you getting in trouble, so we do have to wrap up here.
It happens.
Yeah. Sorry, everybody. This has been fun. I think to wrap this up, we know it's going to hurt if we do want to pick up Draisaitl. So how bad do you want it to hurt?
Ooh. Yeah, and what I would do is whenever stuff like this happens, I always start following the media of that city. So I'd definitely tune in to Oilers, newspaper, check out their Twitter feed, and just start looking for those tea leaves.
I hear Jim Matheson is a good follow.
Oh, hell no. I'm not giving him a follow.
I'm just kidding.
I'll follow somebody who retweets him.
All right. Thanks for tuning in, everybody. Hit that like button if you got a second. Subscribe so you don't miss the next episode as we track when Draisaitl becomes a Detroit Red Wing. And head on over to Apple Podcasts. Subscribe, rate, and review does us the most good. Spotify's also checking those ratings now. So if you have Spotify, head on over, rate us. We'll feel good about it. You'll feel good about it. And more people are going to find us. And of course, if you want to support us financially, we have fun t-shirts, bodpodcast.com, and Tristan's t-shirt will be coming that just says sell the farm. We'll have a nice little farm labeled as a Red Wing farm. I don't know. Maybe I'll put a silhouette of like Jeff Blashill or something. Is anybody going to know it's Jeff Blashill? It's just going to be a random bald guy.
I don't think Jeff Blashill would know it's Jeff Blashill.
All right. We'll wrap up the show with Tristan's last offer. 5 years of first round picks. Mike, would you do it?
And we keep all of our prospects?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's do it. That's what I'm doing in the video game.
Let's go, Tristan's on board. Let's do it. All right, thanks for tuning in, everybody. Have a good one.